What's driven my research and inventing is curiosity, 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 curiosity. How do things work? Why do things work? Why is it possible to do some things and not others?
You've heard a lot about the science of art, going back to the drums, the spoken word. I'm going to talk a little bit about the art of science, because there's very little difference between art and science, because they both depend on what? Creativity. Creativity. You're creating something new.
If you've ever used a cell phone or hearing aid, listened to music, or recorded any audio yourself, you can thank this man, James Edward West, for one of the technologies that makes it possible. West is the co-inventor of the Electret microphone. It's estimated that over 90% of all microphones today use the technology.
Everything has an Electret microphone.
When I really think about the reach and magnitude of my father's work, to know that an African-American man is responsible for the devices in everyone's pocket, yet no one really knows that story.
James Edward Maceo West was born in 1931 and is a revolutionary American inventor and acoustician. His mother was one of the Hidden Figures, a group of black women who worked for NASA as human computers in the 1960s.
As a young child, he loved to tinker. We've talked about tinkering before. Think about Lonnie Johnson. And at 8 years old, he went to repair a broken radio. When he fixed it, he stood up on the bed to plug it in, and it sent a jolt, as the story goes, of electricity through him. His brother saw what was happening and knocked him off the bed and disabled the current there, saved his life probably. But rather than deterring him from leaning into science, it gave him more curiosity about science. And it's part of the reason that he does what he does today. James had dyslexia. And particularly for our students, I want you to listen to that. He did not let his dyslexia stop him. And he earned top grades in his classes, and he was accepted to attend Temple University in 1953. And when he told his parents he was going to study physics, they tried to stop him, and they introduced him to three people in his community who had studied chemistry and physics, and they all worked at the post office. And as the story goes, his dad said, "You're destined for a career in the post office."
Despite his parents' hope he would go to college and study medicine, James West wanted physics and went to work as a summer intern at Bell Labs. West joined Bell Labs full-time in 1957. And by 1962, he and a colleague, Gerhard Sessler, had patented a revolutionary new Electret microphone technology.
It revolutionized microphones in the sense that it condensed a microphone at the time in the 60s when we started this work. You couldn't buy a condenser microphone for less than $2,000. By eliminating the need for the battery, this meant that you could make something very simple.
The real reason that I settled on Bell Labs was the fact that there were other people who looked like me that I wanted to be like when I grew up. Link Hawkins, who turned out to be my mentor, was the first black member of the technical staff at Bell Labs 2 years before Jackie Robinson broke into major baseball.
90% of all microphones used today are based on patents he developed at Bell Laboratories. What I saw was not only a black scientist making a major influential technical achievement, he leveraged his success for the next generation of scientists.
Despite obstacles of racial prejudice in his life, West became a leader in his field, encouraging more minorities to jump into science and pursue advanced degrees.
One of the things that we did was to convince the board of directors that Bell Labs needed, and AT&T at that time, needed to do something to promote diversity in STEM. And we had many summer programs. The one that I'm most proud of was the Corporate Research Fellowship Program, which funded, mentored, and graduated roughly 600 women and underrepresented minority PhDs. And this was done over a period of about 30 years.
I was a founder of the Association of Black Laboratory Employees, and through ABLE, we generated the program, which graduated more than 500 PhDs from underrepresented minorities and women. We worked for each other. We helped each other advance in the system. This group made substantial contributions to telephony and communications.
After nearly 40 years at Bell Labs, Dr. West joined the faculty of the Johns Hopkins University.
Retirement has never been in the picture for me so far, primarily because I enjoy what I do, and going to work is truly a pleasure. I collaborate with people in materials engineering and chemistry and optics and a number of other divisions, including work at Johns Hopkins Hospital.
When I think about the lack of representation in my space, it's something that I am determined to change, just as my father did at Bell Labs.
I mentor as many people as I possibly can. The cycle continues because this is what creates the Renaissance.
The reason why I'm even able to fill this role for my company is because he had already shown me that anything is possible.
When I applied to Johns Hopkins University, Dr. West saw that my advisor was his former mentee, and he reached out to me. And when I looked him up, I was like, what? This is the guy that just called me? It feels awesome to be a part of the legacy that Dr. West is really trying to spearhead with diversifying STEM. I mean, that's really one of the reasons why I wanted to pursue a PhD.
Now in his 80s, West shows no signs of slowing down in his commitment to see more opportunities given to minorities and to generate a more diverse population in science.
I spend an awful lot of time mentoring, especially underrepresented minority and women students here, because I know that there are impediments and shortcomings that are the result of just the way the system is, and the fact that the competition gets stiffer as you climb higher.
Granville T. Woods, he's one of my heroes. I found a patent from 1884 on a telephone transmitter. Granville T. Woods sold his patent for his telephone transmitter to A.G. Bell. And this is better known as the carbon microphone. The carbon microphone was the first microphone in the telephone, only to be replaced by what? The electret microphone. So you see, as far as telecommunications is concerned, the very front end of telecommunications, the very front end of entertainment, the microphone, right, really started with a black man and continued by a black man.
He feels that his greatest accomplishments are his four children, Melanie, Lori, James, and Ellington. And in honor of James West and his son Ellington, I thought we would lean into an artist that used the microphone to be heard. So we're going to perform a little Take the A Train today. Billy Strayhorn wrote the song. He was a collaborator with Duke Ellington. Ella Fitzgerald is one of the ones who made this popular. She sang with the microphone as well. So I hope you'll enjoy me going outside of my element a little bit today, doing my best to give us a little jazz piano and singing along. Let's have fun, friends. 5, 6, 7, 8. Way up in Harlem. If you miss the A train, you find you will miss the quickest way to get to Harlem.
Mm-hmm. take,
if you should take
a train,
Mario,
you get to where you're going in a hurry.
Mario.
Hurry, 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 now it's coming.
Mario.
Can't you hear the bells will hum? Leota, if you should miss
Mario.
The A train.
If you miss the A train, you will find you miss the quickest way to Harlem.
Hurry, get on now, it's coming. Listen to those rails are thrumming.
All aboard, get on the A train. Soon you will be on Sugar Hill in Harlem.
Ernie Shepherd.